In this video, I'm going to show you how to use a few different kinds of alerts in SwiftUI. We'll do just a basic alert, we'll do alerts with multiple buttons, alerts with text fields, and even how to pass in errors to your alerts so you don't need so many alert modifiers all throughout your code. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. Here I am in Xcode, and I just have three buttons on my screen that we're going to use to trigger those various types of alerts. Not much of a starter project, but there's two things you need to know when it comes to alerts. And the first is, how do you trigger an alert, like know when to show it? And then the second is the UI of alert, like buttons, text fields, etc. So let's talk about the triggering of an alert first. With SwiftUI, we need a state variable that we're going to change whenever we want to trigger an alert, and then the alert modifier watches the status of our state variable, and then when that changes, it triggers the alert. Let's type that out. So at state private var is showing basic alert. That is false by default. So when do we want to flip this to true so we trigger an alert? So in our fetch data button, we're gonna kinda simulate when a network call, maybe you're fetching some data from a server, when that fails. Now, of course, that's not on button press. It would be in your networking code. When you get the error, you can flip is showing basic alert to true when you get the error in your code, and then that will trigger the alert. So that is how things are triggered. Now let's talk about the UI to get it to display. Well, that is a modifier on your view. I'm gonna put them on each button just to show you you can do that. You can also put it on like the overall V stack, but we're gonna do it on the button. So dot alert, and this is confusing. Look at all these autocompletes, and some of them are deprecated. Quick little history lesson. iOS 13 and 14, you did alerts a different way. iOS 15 changed it and made it much simpler, in my opinion. So if you see these old deprecated ones in a code base, that's because they were, you know, supporting iOS 13 and iOS 14. iOS 15 and above, use these new ones that we're gonna walk through right now. So let's go to title key is presented actions and message. So the title key is what shows up in the title. No network is presented is the trigger, right? And we want to present this when is showing basic alert flips to true. Okay. So dollar sign is showing basic alert. Cool. And now actions and message. I'm going to hit return there. So message is optional. You don't need a message. You don't even need actions here. So let's actually delete that and delete that, and we'll delete the message. I'm going to command Z to get it back. But just to show you what happens when I hit fetch data, we get no network and okay. You don't have to have a message, but that error message looks weird, right? You always see the title and then more detail under it. So that's where this message comes in. So command Z. I wanted to show you that it is optional, but this takes in a text, no network detected, connect to Wi-Fi or cellular and try again. Just a typical error message. But just to show you what that message does, tap fetch data, there you go, no network detected, connect to Wi-Fi or cellular and try again, and you get this OK button by default. You notice in this actions closure, I don't have anything in there, but the OK button shows up because this is where we put our buttons. The OK button is by default and it dismisses, which flips this is showing basic alert back to false. So if all you need is to just tell the user something, they don't have to act, they can't delete anything, they're not confirming or denying, they don't have to enter a text field, this is, you know, a pretty basic alert, and this is what you'll use. But what if you do need options? What if you are deleting an object or submitting a text field input? Well, let's work on that. So again, in this actions closure, we can start adding some buttons. Button, a title key, and an action. And we can say, this is just try again. And then the action would be, you know, do try again code, whatever code that is to actually try the network call again for your app. So now we'll say button, and now I wanna go to a different autocomplete, right? Because we want a role here, because there's a couple different roles we can use. For this one, let's just bear with me here, pretend we can delete something on this alert. So we'll do delete, and then the role is dot, you see we get destructive or cancel. We'll come back to cancel in a second. So we'll say destructive, and then the action would be, you know, do delete code. Again, whatever you need to do there. So another button, we can say title key, role, action, cancel. And again, this action closure is where I'm putting my actions, which are these buttons. So the button role is dot cancel. And again, we don't have to do anything in here because by default, cancel knows that, hey, I'm just gonna cancel this and dismiss the alert. So most likely no code should go in there unless you wanna do something when the user cancels that's unique to your app. But now when I tap fetch data, you see now I get these three buttons, but you notice they have different styling, right? So try again, that's like the normal button. Delete went red. So if it's destructive, you want to let the user know, oh, hey, you can delete something here. So it's red. And then the cancel button is slightly bolded, as you can see, compared to the try again. And then, of course, whatever button the user picks will execute whatever code you had there. So again, we went over the very basic alert. If you don't put anything in this actions closure, again, I'll just comment this out, hit fetch data. You just get the simple, okay, cool. Let's do a command Z to bring those back. Add your buttons, give it a role, destructive or cancel, and then you get a button action to do whatever code your app needs to do. And there you go, you see three buttons there. All right, let's move on to entering data down here. So we're gonna add a text field. So actually back up, we need to add a specific trigger here. So at state private var is showing enter value alert equals false. So now when we tap our enter data button, that's what we want to do, is showing enter value alert equals true. You could do dot toggle there. I like to say is true because it's very explicit, but that's just me, personal preference there. But anyway, now that we're flipping that toggle, let's show the alert dot alert. And again, title key is presented, actions and a message. So the title key will be enter value is presented, dollar sign is showing enter value alert. Again, make sure you're using the proper trigger here. And then this is all the same as last time, right? We get actions and message. So the message, again, is a text, enter the dollar value of your item. Again, just more descriptive for the message. Now, in the action closure, right, before we just put a bunch of buttons, well now, again, it's pretty simple. I like this new chain. You just do text field. So title key will say value, and then now the text is a binding to a string, just like any text field you would have in SwiftUI. So we need a at state private var value string, and that's gonna equal just an empty string. So down in our text field, we can put a binding to that value string. So now when I tap enter data, you see we get enter value, we can enter, you know, whatever we want, and then hit okay. But we don't have any closure to do something when we hit okay. So if you have a text field, it's probably best to have a button that says like submit, and then that action would be submit value, whatever you need to do in your code base. And then another button, this time we're gonna have the cancel role. So title key role action for cancel, and the role is cancel. And then we don't need anything in our action code there. So now when I enter data, you see I can enter whatever I want, and you have to do some text validation, of course. And then I can either cancel or submit. So if I hit submit, I can run the code to actually submit that, or cancel just dismisses it like nothing happened. So that is adding a text field to your alerts. And what you may be noticing is all these alerts with these specific buttons and specific actions. Well, maybe not the text field one, because that is probably specific to what you want, but this no network one. Well, this is very specific to one type of error. Oftentimes, especially with network calls, right, you get no network, or maybe there's a 404 or whatever URL was passed in, or maybe the server's down, you get an error code 500. There's many, many different types of errors you can get with that network call example. So if we're hard coding all these error messages and actions, you know, we would have a bunch of different alert modifiers, and that's not good. So you can pass in an error and then act accordingly based on whatever error you get. Let me show you. I'm gonna scroll down, and to save a little time, I'm going to paste in this error, our my app error, localized error. I'll run through it to tell you what's going on. Feel free to pause the video right here. Type this out. Again, I did this to save time on the video. So this is just a rough example of an error type. We have three cases, right? We're trying to log in. We have invalid username, invalid password, no network. Of course, there's probably more error types, but three was enough to show you how you can pass in an error and make your alert dynamic. Now, when you have a localized error, you want an error description. This error description is important because this is what the alert used for the title of your alert. I'll actually mess this up so I can show you if you don't have this, that default. You might have seen it before in apps. It's just a bunch of like gibberish, not very user-friendly. And then we can use the failure reason as our message for the alert. So that's what I did here. I created these variables, and then we're switching off of whatever type of error it is, and then we're passing in a specific title and a alert message accordingly based on the error type. So if you have any questions about that, feel free to leave it in the comments, but I'll show you how we can use these errors in an alert to make our alert dynamic. So we're gonna use this login button. Again, first thing we need is a trigger here at state private var is showing login alert equals false. And then on the button tap is showing login alert equals true. And for our alert here, we want to pass in a different initializer. Alert here is presented error in actions. And you can see the error takes in a localized error. So I'm gonna hit return there. Same thing though for is presented. Say is showing login alert. Now the error, we're gonna need a variable that holds this error. And because we're gonna change this dynamically, we'll make it state. At state private var error, and that's of type my app error, and by default we'll make it dot no network. And to show you how we can change this, again we're simulating it on the button tap, error equals dot invalid password. So again, we're simulating when you tap the login button, we run a network call. In your network call code, of course, you're going to handle all the errors, and then based on whatever error gets fired off, you can set the error equal to that error. Again, in this simulation, I'm just doing it on button tap. So the error that we want to pass in here to localize the error is our error that we just created up top. And then same thing, actions and message, except now we have an error that we can pass in, right? You notice this closure here, same thing, localized error, error. And then this is where the magic happens. So for our message, we can do text error dot failure reason. Again, if I go back down to my error, you see our failure reason right here. Whether the error is an invalid username, invalid password, it's going to, you know, spit out that text. And to test this, we'll actually just get rid of the placeholder and we'll have no button in there. So it'll just be the OK button. So now when we tap login, again, we're simulating logging in, it did the network call, something bad happened. And because we set error to invalid password here, we're seeing invalid password. The password entered in the username is correct. And you can see that maps accordingly to our failure reason for invalid password and then our title for invalid password. So back up to our button tap, let's change this to .invalid username. Login, invalid username. So again, we have a dynamic alert here based on the error that we pass in. And we can do even more customizations. Because we have this error here, we can have some logic to do certain things depending on what error we get. Let's say if error equals equals dot invalid username, well, if that's the case, maybe I do want a text field where they can enter the new username and like retry again. So I'll say username and the text, I'm just gonna bind this to value string just for speed. Obviously value string is what we use for the other text field just to get it to work, because all I wanna show you is that we can do different things based on the errors. So if the error is invalid username, I'm going to have a text field with username, and the buttons I'm gonna have are button title key of submit and then nothing in there, and then also a button with a title key and a role of cancel. The role is .cancel, and then no code goes in there, and I need to spell cancel right. Now, invalid username is the error. So if I hit login, now you see I get a username with the proper title and message, and I get a cancel and a submit button. But if I change the error in the button login, again, this is where you would handle it in your network call, to no network, now when I see the login error, I just see the typical title, message, and hit OK. So again, we're conditionally showing a text field, a submit button, a cancel button based on the type of error. And again, this prevents you from having like 8 different alert modifiers to handle all the different error types. So pretty cool stuff. And real quick, just to show you the gibberish you get. So if I make this not optional, it's gonna go to the default error description. So this does need to be optional. So now when I hit the login button, you see the operation couldn't be completed. Alerts.myApp error 2, right? This is the gibberish I was talking about there. And that is if you didn't have this error description here. And again, make sure it's optional, because then that's how you'll actually get what you typed in there. Login, there you go, no network connection. And when you're building great apps, error handling and alerts are key. And if you're building these awesome apps, you're gonna need a portfolio website to showcase your work so everyone can see it. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build the website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you wanna spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you wanna spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace, handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.